Ah, hello World Wide Web. I'm Dark Shadow, the inner personality of this hair. And ignoring things like the concept of a season or basic perceptions of time whatsoever and keeping a schedule, let's continue. With a look at Child's Play 2. Released 2 years after the original in 1990, Child's Play 2 does the classic slasher act of resurrecting the already killed villain to keep the franchise going, because money! To be fair, the franchise was already about evil magic that allowed you to cheat death, and at least they didn't try and weasel the series off to a character that wasn't Chucky. And as we still have Chucky, we still have Andy, and we follow the logical continuation of the events of the first movie. Ish, some things just kind of happen, but hey, as long as we get more Chucky, am I right? So with that in mind, let's take a look at Child's Play 2, and see if the second edition managed to get all the kinks out. First things first, oh yeah, Chucky did pretty definitively die at the end of the first one, so how the heck does he come back from that? Easy, we can rebuild him. We have the technology to make an incredibly stupid mistake. Or is it stupid? You see, the police were just like, talking doll? What talking doll? But Karen Barclay was insistent that the good guy's doll came alive and started murdering people. And the good guy's company doesn't want that bad press around their money printing machine. So they figured, hey, why not get the original doll, put it back together, and prove it was just a doll? What's the worst that could happen? Oh, that's right. The body count rising. So he's fucking dead, but don't let that bother you. The CEO, Mr. Sullivan, played by Peter Haskell, has to just say fuck it and leave for a meeting, leaving the task of getting the confirmed non-possessed, non-homicidal doll disposal duty to his lackey, Mattson, played by Greg German.
What do you want me to do with the doll? Stick it up your ass.
Whoa! I didn't know this company was making those kind of toys. Anyway, how's Andy doing? Locked up as a troubled youth in the foster system, while his mother is locked up in an asylum. Don't worry, that just means new parents! The Simpsons! Joanne, played by Jenny Ogutter, and Phil, played by Jarrett Graham. You know, Beef from Phantom of the Paradise and Bud from Chud 2, Bud the Chud. What? Am I the only Jarrett Graham superfan around? But hearing about all those murders and how this poor kid just pretends it was his doll in order to cope, Phil says, are we even qualified to look after someone like that?
Well, I understand your concern, Mr. Simpson, but I'm sure you can see that this is just a child's way of coping with a difficult situation.
And as far as I can tell, the official word is that Andy just says the doll murdered the people to cope with the murders that really did happen, as all those real people were really killed for real. And they were killed somehow, but not by the doll. All right, case closed. So that's that. Andy Barclay is now living with the Simpsons. And don't you worry, all that trauma about those killings is all water under the bridge. The good guy's doll can't hurt you anymore. And if you've been watching my streams playing American Truck Simulator on the gaming channel, you already know that one was probably my fault. But big rig truck in the Texas way ain't gonna stop the Simpsons, who bring Andy home safe and sound. Getting the important stuff out of the way, we immediately point out a very important, very fragile family heirloom that absolutely, positively must not be broken ever.
It's been in my family for 3 generations. My grandmother gave it to my mother, and my mother gave it to me.
And who are you gonna give it to?
Actually, I was gonna take it down to Pawn Stars, see what they offer for it. Dodging the question, she sends him up towards his room, on his own. That way we can instead meet his new older sister, Kyle, played by Christine Elise. We gotta establish first all real fast, she's a troubled kid in the foster system.
What is this? You've been here 3 weeks. Why haven't you unpacked?
What for? I've never spent more than a month in any home.
Understandable, but if it is just one suitcase worth of clothes, it's arguably harder to shuffle it around and keep it in that one suitcase than it is to take 5 minutes to put it away, and 5 more minutes to put it back once a month's over. But she's a good kid worrying about getting to work so she can make enough money to live when she's out of the foster system and only has herself to rely on. Anyway, enough about angst and concern for your well-being. Look, Andy's room is over here and is filled to the brim with all kinds of toys.
I'm sure you're gonna make all sorts of new friends.
Up to and including that one killed a bunch of people once. Man, it's like if your family had a horrifying accident after a dispute over Monopoly. But this isn't Chucky, look!
Hi, I'm Tommy, and I'm your friend to the end.
See, this one's named after the director of the first movie, Tom Holland. No, not that Tom Holland. Besides, that can't be the real Chucky. Look, that's still in the hands of Mattson, who has been tasked with shoving it up his ass. But oh darn it, the car's truck is absolutely stuffed and it can't fit. There's just no way that he can shove it in there. Ah, well, toss old Chuckles in the back seat. That's close enough. Nothing bad ever comes from a serial killer in your back seat, am I right? Ah, well, should be fine as long as he is a fine, upstanding citizen. On that note, his current obligations are to get drunk and laid. But oh darn it, he forgot to pick up the liquor, so gotta do that along the way. Chucky, it's just a car phone. Those were a thing in the 90s. But wouldn't you know it, Mattson just so happens to have all the case data on the Andy Barclay trial. How convenient! First things first, call up the orphanage for information on Andy's whereabouts.
Andy no longer lives here. Who is this?
This is his uncle, Charles.
And you gotta love how Chucky doesn't even need to come up with a creative lie. He can just straight up tell them his name and they're just not smart enough to put two and two together. They are horror movie characters after all. In any case, when Mattson returns to his car to continue on his quest for inebriated intercourse.
Don't move! Jesus! God, okay, what? Okay, what do you want?
You know, I can't help but feel that if I were in that position, I would have so many more questions. Chucky demands he drive, and so he does. Eventually leading to a secluded parking lot where the doll forces the man to put his hands behind the seat so he can tie them up. And then...
You're dead.
I was wondering where exactly the toy got a toy-sized gun in the back of the toy man's car. Oh, look! It was actually a toy all along. Like I said, horror movie characters, not exactly that smart. And incredibly prone to murder as Chucky takes the thing that is not a toy intended for children, a plastic bag! And don't worry about anyone noticing. Character wasn't that important. And it just so happens this was within walking distance to the Simpsons' residence, allowing Chucky to get inside. But he can't just rush right up to Andy just yet. Dang old loving foster mother is reading bedtime stories, singing, and all kinds of annoying parental affection. It's really getting in the way of evil voodoo magic plants. But looky here, Tommy is around to be his friend to the end.
I'd like to be hugged.
Even better, the priceless heirloom with generations of sentimental value doubles as a handy blunt weapon. Single use, I'm afraid, broken even worse than Tommy, whom Chucky buries in the yard. Most people will go for the trash can, but whatevs. The more noticeable problem is by morning, the family heirloom has absolutely been shattered, and both kids deny any knowledge of what happened. Therefore...
You leave me no choice. Until somebody fesses up, you're both grounded.
I see your logic, Phil, but have you completely ruled out an incredibly short, extremely isolated earthquake? So, yay, punishment! Kyle ain't happy, but isn't supremely infuriated with Andy or anything like that. Andy's more worried about the Simpsons and how that mean old Mr. Simpson seems. But Kyle's like, nah, you're not as bad as you might think. Joanne especially is certainly one of the nicer foster mothers out there. And what do you know? Andy immediately overhears that Phil is concerned that Andy might not really be past his whole killer doll psychosis. But Joanne is confident that these are just growing pains and they'll all be one big happy family soon enough. So Andy's like,
I hate you.
Hi, I'm Tommy.
Somehow Chucky keeps passing every speech check back to back without even trying all that hard. I mean, Andy is a bit suspicious, but after checking the batteries, like, yep, there they are. He's like, eh, good enough. And proudly shows the Simpsons, look, I'm not psycho about the good guy's dolls. Everything is A-okay. They can just play, chill, and everything will be fine. Except for the fact that is Chucky, he is alive and does want to kill you. Minor details. And as his goal is to possess Andy's body before he's trapped in this one forever, obviously he gets right to business. But oh, darn it, Kyle is doing that damn teens and 90s movies thing of coming in through the window for some reason and interrupts the doll.
It's Chucky, look out!
Shut up, you wake Phil and Joel.
Kill him!
Andy, stop it, will you?
What the hell is this now?
Yeah, I gotta be honest with you, Phil. I have no fucking idea. What the hell was she doing climbing into the window of a 6-year-old boy's bedroom? I mean, it's handy that she did, but what the hell?
I don't believe you. You actually tied this child up so we wouldn't tell on you. Is that it?
No, Phil, that makes no sense either. How the hell is that supposed to go down? You see, it was Andy all along. Isn't that right, Andy? Yeah. Andy insists it was Chucky trying to kill him again. So Phil has had enough of this and grabs the good guy's doll, tossing it in the basement, so Andy will finally stop pretending it's alive.
No! I'm turning human again?
Hey, if getting thrown down a flight of stairs only results in a nosebleed, I'd say you're still doing pretty good. Can't keep the kids locked down 24/7, though. Grounded doesn't mean they don't have to go to school. But a new school means we get to see Andy's previously established lack of friends or social skills at work, as absolutely everyone in his class is a total asshole.
Later, repent.
Get lost, microchip.
Am I boring you, Andy?
With the classic combination of childhood bullying and then the teachers being upset at you for being disruptive. Memories. Introducing Miss Kettlewell, played by Beth Grant, who is just looking for a reason to discipline the boy. Oh, what's this now? Terrible penmanship and a complete lack of punctuation. There should be a comma after you, and bits should be finished off with either a period or an exclamation point. This is obviously because Chucky has come to school as well. But Kettlewell is more interested in what Andy was thinking with that note.
But I didn't do it, I swear.
No? Then who did? Don't even think about it. No toys.
Did, like, nobody get briefed on the whole killer doll thing? I mean, they don't gotta believe him, but it helps to have some context. She tosses the doll into the storage room, insisting Andy keep his head down until she returns. But his priority is to get the hell out of there while Chucky demands he open the door.
I promise I won't kill anyone else.
Oh, come on, we still got 45 minutes of movie to go. Yeah, you will. Fortunately, Andy can't escape out the handy-dandy window, so when Miss Kettlewell returns, all she hears is the sounds of someone trying to get out of the storage room. Assuming it to be Andy, she opens the door. But the kid is nowhere to be found. Eh, no reason to worry. Must have been the wind. Or that killer doll, really. Really should have warned her about. Having locked herself in the room with the doll, Miss Kettlewell is beaten to death with a yardstick. Which also goes completely unnoticed. Yeah, she is a smear on the floor of her own classroom, but no one really brings that up for the rest of the movie. Does a school not have janitors or something? I mean, the Simpsons have evidently heard about how he wrote that nasty note on the paper, but nothing about the whole murder thing. Andy blames Chucky for the note, but Phil is having none of it, opening the basement door to show him, look, Tommy is still down there. All this Chucky nonsense is just that nonsense. Now get over it. But there's only one thing Andy can think to do. Use an electric carving knife to carve the bastard. Eh, I like it. It's like a kid-sized chainsaw. But Chucky has moved. Where to? Now, best to check all possible locations, knife first. Okay, well, at least we can tell that you're going to be in a lot of trouble come morning. And as we can expect, he doesn't so much find Chucky as Chucky finds him. Knocking his tiny chainsaw aside, the doll attacks! And Andy barely manages to reach it and get the toy off before da-da-da-da, Phil arrives.
Andy, put down the knife.
But I need it for...
Just put the knife down, and we'll talk about it.
Ain't no way I'm putting down this knife. Unless... Hey, Phil, you got a wood chipper down here somewhere? But as he heads down towards Andy, Chucky hooks his ankle and has him at his mercy.
How's it hanging, Phil?
of which he has none. And of course, everyone else shows up too late to see the doll, but just in time to find the corpse. Still warm. Judging by the body bag and the stretcher, that's about all we're going to be seeing of Phil in this movie. Third Jarrett Graham movie I've reviewed, and he ended up as a corpse in all three of them. Anyway, Joanna's beating herself up over not listening to her husband about that bastard-ass bastard and his bastard-ass. But either way, it's time to ship the little shit back to the orphanage where he can rot for all they care. Andy maintains, it was the doll! Don't let him get you too, Kyle! But she only pays it enough mind to be like,
know your fucking place, trash!
So now it's time for a nice smoke on the swing to try and take your mind off that whole kid just fucked my life up in record time thing. But what's this? It appears that something was buried beneath the swing. You'd think a serial killer would be a little better at hiding those. Obviously, she goes to check the trash bin, but damn those slasher villains and their teleportation powers. Next thing you know, weird noises can be heard from upstairs. So Kyle rushes back inside. And by rushes, I mean goes incredibly slowly and suspensefully, asking way too optimistically if Joanne is okay, when obviously...
Joanne!
She was killed off-screen! The greatest horror of them all. Though that is a close second. So now it's Kyle versus Chucky. But don't worry, she did remember to bring a knife. Ooh, never mind. Worry. Now with a handy-dandy weapon, Chucky has no problem getting the drop on Kyle. But not killing her. Instead, he kidnaps the poor girl, forcing her to drive him to the orphanage where they brought Andy. Problem is, a little time limit on him being able to get out of the doll body has him asking her to go a little too fast, resulting in them getting pulled over. But don't worry, it turns out this officer just loves the good guy dolls.
What the hell's that?
You seen dolls that pee? This one bleeds.
And they got the ones that poop. I really hope they stop this constant arms race of bodily fluids and dolls. Well, that's good enough for Mr. Officer, so he lets them go, but she's not about to let Chucky just roll up and get Andy too, and crashes the car to stop him! Which, doesn't stop him.
Playtime's over.
Ooh, what time is it now? Nap time? Is it nap time? I want Chucky milk. Seems that attempt to slow Chucky down really didn't do all that much as, oh, would you look at that, they were within walking distance of the orphanage. And Grace Poole, played by Grace Zabriskie, wonders why Kyle did something so uncouth as to pull the fire alarm. And what's with the stupid doll?
Don't give me that. Amazing, isn't it?
Man, I heard a doll's having a target demographic, but that's not exactly how I imagined it. And she whacks the Xerox machine so hard, it continues copying pictures of her dead face long after she falls away. But what's this? Chucky gets Andy all alone, and he demands the boy come with.
Snap out of it! You act like you've never seen a dead body before!
Yeah, I mean, at the very least, Andy saw the doctor get his brains fried in the first movie, and let's not forget Phil's neck going 90 degrees earlier today. But now they need to get out of there, and it's crawling with firemen. How will they escape?
Inside! Hurry!
Newspaper delivery truck just rolls right up and stops, with its back completely open. How convenient! And Kyle shows up just fast enough to see Chucky escape with Andy, but not fast enough to stop them. No worries. She crashed in the fucking parking lot, so her car's right there. Catching up to the van, she forces them to stop! But where did Chucky take Andy off to in such short time? Why, the good guy's manufacturing facility, of course! But the door is closing! Well, that was needlessly Indiana Jonesy. But oh, darn it! Someone decided that the factory should be a homage to the hedge maze in The Shining, and man, is it confusing! Which means Chucky has plenty of time to knock Andy out and perform his evil voodoo magic, summoning storms and calling to... I never really learned their name, but he calls forth the power to transfer his soul and the spell.
completes.
But while he had plenty of time to cast a spell, he actually didn't have plenty of time to cast a spell. Well, fiddlesticks. So, new plan. Kill Andy. But what's this? Kyle shows up in the nick of time to save the day, grabbing Andy and trying to find the way out. Problem, though, the aforementioned labyrinthian layout in here and the fact that, oh yeah, this is a horror movie climax, so no, they aren't getting out there, just finding new, interesting ways to have Chucky attempt to murder the fuck out of them. A little roly conveyor, but Kyle can trap Chucky by pinning his hand in the door. Except for one issue. In case you forgot, he really doesn't care for that body. Or insane quantities of blinding pain, I suppose, as he jams the knife into his arm stump, giving him a knife hand. Oh, but we have some other important stuff to establish. The eyeball insertion machine and boiling hot plastic stuff. But it's been 10 minutes since the body count last rose. Let's fix that. Eyeball horror. And it really sucks being the one employee scheduled that night. But what's this? A little button that reverses the assembly line and creates Elden Ring monsters. Well, don't send Chucky through that thing. Or do, as Kyle slams his face, sewing his crotch to the stand and sending him into the graftifier. That results in... whatever this is. So they figure, okay, job done, let's get out of here. But not so fast, for Kyle is slapped into a conveyor by a sudden flying dead guy. Or swinging, anyway.
Got you now, Andy!
Because they didn't kill Chucky. They just left him with less ass than Hank Hill. But whoopsie, Chucky gets stuck, and lo and behold, it's right under the release valve for the boiling plastic, drowning him in... pain goo. This happens so fast, Andy's able to save Kyle from an impromptu decapitation, and they can check the remains of Goo Chucky together. Jesus, this doll is harder to kill than Kevin Bacon in Hollow Man. But one air tube later, and Chucky goes full Garbage Pail Kid, inflating until his head explodes. Therefore, happy ending. As long as you ignore all the dead people and the obvious questions they will bring up. Sun's up, and there's only one question that really matters.
Where are we going?
Home.
Where's home?
Andy, I have no idea.
Well, if they ever get around to acknowledging the teacher, the lady at the orphanage, and the foster mom, probably somewhere with padded walls. Anyway, that was Child's Play 2. And it was a hell of a lot of fun. The original wasn't absolutely perfect, but it was still a tough act to follow up, and Child's Play 2 actually does a pretty damn good job of that. While Chucky's appearance is less varied for the beginning of the film versus his gradual changes in Child's Play 1, and occasional weird suits for half a second of film, Child's Play 2 has one focused look for Chucky, but said look is pretty high quality and adequately terrifying. Similar to Child's Play 1, the story also takes place over only a few days, but even with how short a story it is, it's still a bit hard to explain how the deaths of several characters go seemingly unnoticed. Mainly I'm thinking of the teacher, of course. It is possible that after Chucky turned her into the Friday Sloppy Joe, I just, never checked up on her. The janitor never went in that room that night. And of course, the following events include the death of Phil, the death of Joanne, the death of Grace, and the death of miscellaneous employee number 12. All occurred over the same evening, but shouldn't the police have at least been a little more involved during the investigation into the sudden death of Phil around the kid involved in a whole lot of death recently? Still, considering the nature of the spell, it makes sense things happen quickly, and when they happen that fast, there might not be enough time for characters to notice things. I get it. But, yeah. Remember how Mattson died within walking distance of the Simpson house? Never heard anything after that one either. At the end of the day, Child's Play 2 is a fun little slasher as long as you're not a nitpicky asshole like me looking to poke holes in plots, whether or not they're actually worth getting upset about. Chucky's doing his thing, Kyle's a fun character, Alex Vincent does a good job acting as Andy despite his age, and the body count rises, coming in at 3 good guys' death machines out of 5. As in the death machines in the factory, not the dolls. Though I guess those could count too. Anyway, thank you all for watching. I've been Decker Shadow. And remember, it was a different Tom Holland.
Florent!
Get real, this is a station wagon.
Shit!